When I look at this, and these are 3 billion chemical letters, instructions for a human being, my eyes glaze over. But when scientist Eric Lander looks at this, he sees stories.
The genome is a storybook that's been edited for a couple billion years. And you couldn't take it to bed like 1001 Arabian Nights and read a different story in the genome every night.
This is the story of one of the greatest scientific adventures ever. And at the heart of it is a small, very powerful molecule, DNA. For the past 10 years, scientists all over the world have been painstakingly trying to read the tiny instructions buried inside our DNA. And now, finally, the human genome has been decoded.
We're at the moment the scientists wait for. This is what we wanted to do. You know, we're now examining and interpreting the genetic code.
This is the ultimate imaginable thing that one could do scientifically, is to go and look at our own instruction book and then try to figure out what it's telling us.
And what it's telling us is so surprising and so strange and so unexpected. 50% of the genes in a banana are in us?
How different are you from a banana?
I feel, and I feel I can say this with some authority, very different from a banana.
You may feel different.
I eat a banana.
All the machinery for replicating your DNA, all the machinery for controlling the cell cycle, the cell surface, for making nutrients, all that's the same.
So what does any of this information have to do with you or me? Perhaps more than we could possibly imagine. Which one of us will get cancer, or arthritis, or Alzheimer's? Will there be cures? Will parents in the future be able to determine their children's genetic destinies?
We've opened the box here that has got a huge amount of valuable information. It is the key to understanding disease and in the long run to curing disease. But having opened it, we're also going to be very uncomfortable with that information for some time to come.
Yeah, some of the information you're about to see will make you very uncomfortable. On the other hand, some of it I think you will find amazing and hopeful. I'm Robert Krulwich, and tonight we will not only report the latest discoveries of the Human Genome Project, you will meet the people who made those discoveries possible and who competed furiously to be first to be done. And as you watch our program on the human genome, we will be raising a number of issues: genes and privacy, genes and corporate profits, genes and the odd similarity between you and the yeast. And we'd like to have your thoughts on all these subjects, so please, if you will, log on to NOVA's website. It's located at pbs.org. It'll be there after the broadcast, so do it after the broadcast, where you can take a survey. The results will be immediately available and continually updated. We'll be right back.
Major funding for NOVA is provided by the Park Foundation, dedicated to education and quality television.
This program is funded in part by the Northwestern Mutual Foundation. Some people already know Northwestern Mutual can help plan for your children's education. Are you there yet? Northwestern Mutual Financial Network.
Scientific achievement is fueled by the simple desire to make things clear. Sprint PCS is proud to support NOVA.
Major funding for this program is provided by the National Science Foundation, America's investment in the future, and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
To begin,
Let's go back 4 and some billion years ago to wherever it was that the first speck of life appeared on Earth. Maybe on the warm surface of a bubble.
That speck did something that has gone on uninterrupted ever since. It wrote a message. It was a chemical message that it passed to its children, which then passed it on to its children and to its children and so on.
The message has passed from the very first organism all the way down through time to you and me. Like a continuous thread through all living things. It's more elaborate now, of course, but that message, very simply, is the secret of life. And here is that message contained in this stunning little constellation of chemicals we call DNA. You've seen it in this form, the classic double helix. But since we're going to be spending a lot of time talking about DNA, I wondered, what does it look like when it's raw, you know, in real life? So I asked an expert.
I mean, DNA has a reputation for being such a mystical, highfalutin sort of molecule, all this information, your future, your heredity. It's actually goop. See, this here is DNA.
Professor Eric Lander is a geneticist at MIT's Whitehead Institute.
It's very, very long strands of molecules, these double helices of DNA, which when you get them all together, just look like little threads of cotton.
And these strands were literally pulled from cells, blood cells, or maybe skin cells, of a human being.
Whoever contributed this DNA, you can tell from this whether or not they might be at early risk for Alzheimer's disease. You can tell whether or not they might be at early risk for breast cancer. And there's probably about 2,000 other things you can tell that we don't know how to tell yet, but we'll be able to tell. And it's really incredibly unlikely that you could tell all that from this. But that's DNA for you. That apparently is the secret of life, just hanging off there on the tube.
And already, DNA has told us things that no one had expected. It turns out that human beings have only twice as many genes as a fruit fly. Now, how can that be? We are such complex and magnificent creatures, and fruit flies, they're fruit flies. DNA also tells us that we are more closely related to worms and to yeast than most of us would ever have imagined. But how do you read what's inside a molecule? Well, if it's DNA, if you turn it so you can look at it from just the right angle, you will see, in the middle, what look like steps in a ladder. Each step is made up of two chemicals, cytosine and guanine, or thymine and adenine. They come always in pairs called base pairs, either C and G, or T and A for short. This is, step by step, a code, 3 billion steps long, the formula for a human being.
We're all familiar with this thing. This shape is very familiar.
Double helix, yeah.
Double helix. First of all, I'm wondering, this is my version of a DNA molecule. Is this, by the way, what it looks like?
Well, give or take. I mean, cartoon version
of it. Cartoon version.
You know, a little like that or so, yeah.
So there are, in almost every cell in your body, if you look deep enough, you will find this chain here.
Oh, yes, stuck in the nucleus of your cell.
Now, how small is this? If in a real DNA molecule, the distance between the two walls is how wide?
Oh, golly.
Look at this. He's asking for help.
This distance is about, from this distance, about 10 angstroms, which is...
That's 1/1,000,000,000 of a meter when it's clumped up in a very particular way.
Well, no, it's curled up some like that, but you see, it's more than that. You can't curl it up too much because these little negatively charged things will repel each other. Oh. So you fold it on its... I'm going to break your model.
Don't break my model.
I don't want to break your model. But, you know, you got this, and then it's folded up like this, and then those are folded up on top of each other. And so, in fact, if you were to stretch out all of the DNA, it would run, thousands and thousands of feet. Okay.
But what the main thing about this is the ladder, is the steps of this ladder. If I knew it was A and T and C and C and G and G and A.
Whatever the rules are of the grammar.
If I could read each of the individual ladders, I might find the picture of what?
Of your children. This is what you pass to your children. Oh. You know, people have known for 2,000 years that your kids look a lot like you. Yeah. Well, it's because you must pass them something, some instructions that give them the eyes they have and the hair color they have and the nose shape they do. The only way you pass it to them is in these sentences. That's it.
And to show you the true power of this molecule, we're going to start with one atom deep inside. We pull back and you see it form its A's and T's and C's and G's and the classic double spiral. And then it starts the mysterious process that creates a healthy new baby. And the interesting thing is that every human baby, every baby born, is 99.9% identical in its genetic code to every other baby. So the tiniest differences in our genes can be hugely important, can contribute to differences in height, physique, maybe even talents, aptitudes, and can also explain what can break, what can make us sick. Cracking the code of those minuscule differences in DNA that influence health and illness is what the Human Genome Project is all about. Since 1990, scientists all over the world in university and government labs have been involved in a massive effort to read all 3 billion A's, T's, G's, and C's of human DNA. They predicted it would take at least 15 years. That was partly because in the early days of the project, a scientist could spend years, an entire career, trying to read just a handful of letters in the human genome. It took 10 years to find the one genetic mistake that causes cystic fibrosis. Another 10 years to find the gene for Huntington's disease. 15 years to find one of the genes that increase the risk for breast cancer. One letter at a time, painfully, slowly, frustratingly prone to mistakes,
C's in a row,
and false leads.
A.
We asked Dr. Robert Waterston, a pioneer in mapping DNA, to show us the way it used to be done.
The original ladders for DNA sequence, we actually read by putting a little letter next to the band that we were calling and then writing those down on a piece of paper or into the computer after that. It's horrendous.
And we haven't mentioned the hardest part. This here, magnified 50,000 times, is an actual clump of DNA, chromosome 17. Now, if you look inside, you will find, of course, hundreds of millions of A's and C's and T's and G's, but it turns out that only about 1% of them are active and important. These are the genes that scientists are searching for. So somewhere in this dense chemical forest are genes involved in deafness, Alzheimer's, cancer, cataracts, but where? This is such a maze, scientists need a map. But at the old pace, that would take close to forever.
A C and then an A.
And then came the revolution. In the last 10 years, the entire process has been computerized. That cost hundreds of millions of dollars. But now, instead of decoding only a few hundred letters by hand in a day, together these machines can do 1,000 every second. And that has made all the difference.
this is something that's going to go in the textbooks. Everybody knows that. Everybody, when the Genome Project was being born, was consciously aware of their role in history.
Getting the letters out has been described as finding the blueprint of a human being, finding a manual for a human being, finding the code of a human being. What's your metaphor?
Oh, golly gee. I mean, you can have very highfalutin metaphors for this kind of stuff. This is basically a parts list, right? Blueprints and all these fancy, it's just a parts list. It's a parts list with a lot of parts. If you take an airplane, a Boeing 777,
yeah.
I think it has like 100,000 parts. If I gave you a parts list for the Boeing 777, in one sense, you'd know a lot. You'd know 100,000 components that have got to be there, screws and wires and rudders and things like that. On the other hand, I bet you wouldn't know how to put it together, and I bet you wouldn't know why it flies.
Right.
Well, we're in the same boat. We now have a parts list. That's what the Human Genome Project is about, is getting the parts list. If you want to understand the plane, you have to have the parts list, but that's not enough to understand why it flies. But of course, you'd be crazy not to start with the parts list.
And one reason it's so important to understand all those parts to decode every letter of the genome is because sometimes, out of 3 billion base pairs in our DNA, just one single letter can make a difference. Allison and Tim Lord are parents of 2-year-old Hayden.
Hi, Pumpkin.
The two things that I think of the most about Hayden, which a lot of people got from him right from the beginning, is that he was always, I thought, very funny.
Make your very, 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 very
serious
face.
I mean, he loved to smile and laugh, and he just used to guffaw. I mean, this was later when he was about 1 year old. He just found the funniest things hilarious, and so he and I would just crack each other up.
Hayden seemed to be developing normally for the first few months, but Allison began to notice that some things were not quite right.
I was so very anxious all the time with Hayden. I sensed that something was not the same. I would see my friends changing the diaper of their child who was around the same age, their newborn, and see the physical movement and the legs moving and things like that, and Hayden didn't do that.
Happy birthday!
Doctors told them that Hayden was just developing a bit slowly, but by the time he turned 1 year old, it was clear something serious was wrong. He never crawled, he never talked, he never ate with his fingers, and he seemed to be going backwards, not progressing.
I remember the last time he laughed.
Yeah.
And I took a trip with him out to pick up a suit because we were going to a wedding that night, and we came back and it was really windy and he just loves to feel the wind, and so we had a great time. We came back and I propped him up right here on the couch and I was sitting next to him, and he just kind of threw his head back and laughed like, what a fun trip, and that's the last time he was able to laugh. That's really hard.
It turned out that Hayden had Tay-Sachs disease, a genetic condition that slowly destroys a baby's brain.
What happens is the child appears normal at birth and over the course of the first year begins to miss developmental milestones. So at 6 months, a child should be turning over. A child is unable to turn over, to sit up, to stand, to walk, to talk.
Tay-Sachs begins at one infinitesimal spot on the DNA ladder when just one letter goes wrong. Say this cluster of atoms is a picture of that letter. A mistake here can come down to just 4 atoms. That's it. But since genes create proteins, that error creates a problem in this protein, which is supposed to dissolve fat in the brain. So now the protein doesn't work, so fat builds up, swells the brain,
and eventually strangles and crushes critical brain cells. And all of this is the result of one bad letter in that baby's DNA.
In most cases, it's a single base change, as we say, a letter difference.
Yeah. One defective letter out of 3 billion, and no way to fix it.
That's my boy.
Tay-Sachs is a relentlessly progressive disease. In the years since his diagnosis, Hayden has gone blind. He can't eat solid food. It's harder and harder for him to swallow. He can't move on his own at all. And he has seizures as often as 10 times a day.
For children with classical Tay-Sachs disease, there's only one outcome. And children die by age 5 to 7, sometimes even before age 5.
As it happens, Tim Lord has an identical twin brother. When Hayden was diagnosed, that brother, Charlie, went to New York to be with Tim. And of course, Charlie called his wife, Blythe, to tell her the news. Blythe had been Allison's roommate in college and her best friend.
What are you going to say about that?
Charlie told me that Hayden had Tay-Sachs. He called me on the phone and he told me immediately what it was. I went up onto the computer and looked it up and then just couldn't believe what I read.
Did you finish your cookie?
Blythe and Charlie had a 3-year-old daughter, Taylor, and a baby girl named Cameron. Cameron was healthy and happy, except for one small thing.
On the NTSAD website, it talks about the typically between 6 and 8 months is when the signs start coming, but one of the early signs is that they startle easily. And Hayden had always had a really heavy startle response. Well, we'd noticed that Cameron had a comparable startle response, not quite as severe, but absolutely not like Taylor had had.
As soon as she saw that early warning sign on the Tay-Sachs website, Blythe went to get herself and Cameron tested.
It was another week. It was exactly a week until we got the final results on Cameron's blood work. And then the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, we went into our pediatrician's office and he had the results, and we found out that night that Blythe was a carrier and that
Cameron had Tay-Sachs.
He said,
all I said was, I'm sorry.
Tay-Sachs is a very rare condition. It usually occurs in specific groups, like Ashkenazi Jews, and even then, the baby must inherit the bad gene from both parents. So even though there is a Tay-Sachs test, the Lords had no reason to think they would be at risk. And yet, incredibly, all four of them, Tim and Charlie and both their wives, all four were carriers. That was an unbelievably bad roll of the genetic dice.
Hey, little nugget.
Charlie and I are incredibly close. And have been all our lives.
Yeah.
And when I think about him and Blythe having to go through this, it just seems really cruel. It just seems too much.
I had already geared myself up for being my brother's rock. And I couldn't imagine having to help him and go through it myself.
Blythe.
For families like the Lords, and for everybody, the Human Genome Project offers the chance to find out early if we're at risk for all kinds of diseases.
I love Taylor.
I would like to see a really aggressive push to develop a test for hundreds of genetic diseases so that parents could be informed before they started to have children as to the dangers that face them. And I think it's within our grasp. Now that they've mapped the human gene, I mean, the information is there for people to begin to sort through. They're horrible, horrible, horrible diseases. And if there's any way that you can be tested for a whole host of them and not have them affect a child, I think it's something that we have to focus on.
Hayden Lord died a few months before his third birthday. What makes this story especially hard to bear is we now know that a loss that huge, and it was a catastrophe by any measure, started with a single error, a few atoms across, buried inside a cell. Now, that something so small could trigger such an enormous result is a perspective that is incredibly frightening, except that now geneticists have figured out how to see many of these tiny errors before they become catastrophes. When you think about that, that's an extraordinary thing, to spot a catastrophe when it's still an insignificant dot in a cell, which is the promise of the Human Genome Project. It is, first and foremost, an early warning system for a host of diseases, which will give, hopefully, parents, doctors, and scientists an advantage that we have never had before. Because when you can see trouble coming way, way before it starts, you have a chance to stop it or treat it. Eventually, you might cure it.
And that's why, when Congress created the Human Genome Project in 1990, the challenge was to get a complete list of our A's, T's, C's, and G's as quickly as possible. So the business of making tests, medicines, and cures could begin. They figured it would take about 15 years to decode a human being, and at the time, that seemed reasonable. Until this man, scientist, entrepreneur, and speedboat enthusiast Craig Venter, decided that he could do it faster, much faster.
It's like sailing. Once you have two sailboats on the water going approximately in the same direction, they're racing. And science works very much the same way. If you have two labs remotely working on the same thing, one tries to get there faster or better, you know, higher quality, something different. In part because our society recognizes only first place.
Back in 1990, Venter was one of many government scientists painstakingly decoding proteins and genes. His focus was one protein in the brain.
It took 10 years to get the protein, and it took a whole year to get 1,000 letters of genetic code.
For Venter, that was way too slow.
So you're sitting there thinking there must be a better way, is that what you're, when you're gazing out the window?
Yeah. And then there had to be a better way.
And that's when he learned that someone had invented a new machine that could identify C's and T's and A's and G's with remarkable speed. And Craig Venter just loves machines that go fast.
I immediately contacted the company to see if I could get one of the first machines.
And here's how they work. Human DNA is chopped by robots into tiny pieces. These pieces are copied over and over again in bacteria and then tagged with colored dyes. A laser bounces light off each snip of DNA, and the colors that it sees represent individual letters in the genetic code. And these computers can do this 24 hours a day, every day.
So now you can see clearly the peaks. Yeah. So there's just a blue one coming up, so that's a C coming up. So you could read this and you could write this all down.
So blue, yellow, red, red, yellow.
So that's C, G, T, T, A.
Then somehow all these little pieces have to be put together again in the right order. Venter's dream was to have hundreds of new machines at his fingertips, so he quit his government job and formed a company he called Celera Genomics. Celera, from the Latin word celerity, meaning speed. And this is what he built.
Oh, my Lord. And you know what? It's interesting. There's like there's almost nobody here.
Yeah. It's all automated.
So who is this guy, and why is he such a bulldog for speed? Craig Venter grew up in California, left high school, and spent a year as a surfing bum on the beach by day, and a stock boy at Sears by night. He was inevitably drafted, went to Vietnam with the Navy. That's him way over there on the left. He was eventually assigned to a naval hospital in Da Nang during the Tet Offensive when Americans were taking very heavy casualties. At 21, he was in the triage unit where they decide who will live and who will die.
When you're young and you see a lot of people die, and they all could be you, do you then feel that you sort of owe them cures? Cures that they'll never get? Or am I over-romanticizing?
Well, the motivations become complex. That's certainly a part of it. Also, I think surviving the year there was it puts things in perspective that I think if you're not in that situation, you can never truly have in perspective.
So you hear you hear ticking.
Yeah. But also I feel that I've had this tremendous gift for all these years since I got back in 1968, and I wanted to make sure I did something with it.
In the spring of 1998, Venter announced that he and his company were going to sequence all 3 billion letters of the human genome in 2 years.
Hello?
Remember, the government said it was going to take 15.
There was a lot of arrogance that went with that program. They were going to do it at their pace, and a lot of the scientists, you know, if they were really being honest with you, would tell you that they planned to retire doing this program. You know, that's not what we think is the right way to do science, especially science that affects so many people's lives.
Craig's a high testosterone male who just loves being an iconoclast, right? He loves rattling people's cages, and he's done that consistently in the Genome Project.
Craig Venter's announcement that his team would finish the entire genome in just 2 years galvanized everybody working on the public project. Now, they were scrambling to keep up.
There are some limitations. We don't think we can get this thing to go any faster at the moment without throwing a lot more robotics at it. The arm physically takes 20 seconds to move.
Francis Collins, the head of the Human Genome Project, was determined that Solera was not going to beat his teams to the prize. He made a dramatic decision to try to cut 5 full years off the original plan.
The draft to finish.
Would that be an okay way to do it?
When the major genome centers met and agreed to go for broke here, I don't think there was anybody in the room that was very confident we could do that. I mean, you could sit down with a piece of paper and make projections if everything went really well that might get you there, but there were so many ways this could have just run completely off the track.
At MIT, they decided to try to scale up their effort 15-fold, and that meant a major change in their usual academic pace.
We basically had a goal since March to get to a plate-a-minute operation from womb to tomb all the way through.
In the fall of 1999, representatives from the 5 major labs come to check out Eric Lander's operation. All the big honchos in the Human Genome Project are here, scientists from Washington University in St. Louis, Baylor College of Medicine in Texas, the Department of Energy. She's from the Sanger Center in England. If they want to finish the genome before Craig Venter, these folks have to figure out how to outfit their labs with a lot of new and fancy and unfamiliar equipment, and they've got to do it fast.
So we'll have to run some sort of a conduit.
At MIT, a different crate is arriving almost daily.
It's like Christmas. Everyone unwraps something.
Just like a bad Christmas present, assembly is required, and the instructions are, of course, not always clear.
All in right. Probably have to rip these out. Oh, no, do the magnet plates stick to each other?
Yep.
This is about right, plus or minus 3 feet.
Since one's on the cutting edge, I guess they always call it the bleeding edge, right? Yes. Nothing really is working as you expect. All of the stuff we're doing will be working perfectly as soon as we're ready to junk it.
Right, right.
The MIT crew is particularly excited about their brand new $300,000 state-of-the-art DNA purifying machine.
All right. Maiden voyage. It didn't ask me for a passport. That's good. On it goes.
You get the yellow light right away. That's okay. That's.
I don't think the blinking light is a good sign.
Oh, look at this.
There goes SMC mode.
It's sort of like flying a very large plane and repairing it while you're flying. And you want to figure out what went wrong. And you also realize that you're spending, tens of thousands of dollars an hour. So you feel under a little pressure to sort of work this out as quickly as you can.
So he calls the customer service line. And of course, he's put on hold. So he waits. And he waits. And he waits. Anyway, it turns out that the $300,000 machine does have one tiny little valve that's broken, and so it doesn't work.
All right.
You never know whether the problem is due to some robot, some funky bit of biochemistry, some chemical that you got that isn't really working. And so, it's like incredibly complicated.
So we have a test transformation where we transform a tenth of our ligation.
And add STS to lyse the phage and all of our thermocyclers at 3D four well plates.
So if you basically determine where your 96 well plate wells were on this 384 well plate and give them each a different run module.
Try to ramp something up. Anything that's the slightest bit kludgy suddenly becomes a major bottleneck.
We talked about doing a full-up test today, and we weren't quite feeling good about doing that yet, so.
There was a considerable sense of white knuckles amongst all of us, because here we'd made this promise. We were on the record here saying we're going to do this, and things weren't working. The machines were breaking down.
They haven't got them all in right, so it's just a quick swap.
This is like November?
Yep. And it's got to work now. The time is running out.
This was just delivered on Tuesday, so this is one of its three inaugural runs, and it seems to be flawless so far.
It took a while, but the government teams finally hit their stride.
But the fall of that year was really sort of the determining time. The centers really proved their mettle, and every one of them began to catch this rising curve and ride it, and we began to see data appearing at prodigious rates. By early 2000, 1,000 base pairs a second were rolling out of this combined enterprise. 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, 1,000 base pairs a second. Then it really starts to go.
And those thousands of base pairs poured out of the university labs directly onto the internet. Updated every night, it's available for anybody and everybody, including, by the way, the competition.
Customers love our data.
Solera admits they got lots of data directly from the government. And Tony White, who runs the company that owns Solera, says, why not?
That's publicly available data. I'm a taxpayer. Solera's a taxpayer. You know, it's publicly available. Why should we be excluded from getting it? I mean, again, are they creating it to give it to mankind except Solera? Is that the idea? It isn't about us getting the data. It's about this academic jealousy. It's about the fact that our data, in combination with theirs, gives us a perceived unfair advantage over this so-called race.
If they want to race us,
of course
that's their business.
Don't they want to?
I suspose they may.
I suspect strongly
that they may. Our job is to get that data out there so everybody can go use it.
Since Solera was sequencing the genome with private money, some critics wondered why should the government pour so much cash into the exact same research?
In the United States, we invested in a national highway system in the 1950s. We got tremendous return for building roads for free and letting everybody drive up and down them for whatever purpose they wanted. We're building a road up and down the chromosomes for free. People can drive up and down those chromosomes for anything they want to. They can make discoveries, they can learn about medicine, they can learn about history, whatever they want. It is worth the public investment to make those roads available.
But wait a second. What I really want to know is if you're making a roadmap of a human being, which human beings are we mapping?
I mean, humans come in so many varieties, so whose genes exactly are we looking at?
Yeah, it's mostly a guy from Buffalo and a woman from Buffalo. That's because the laboratory
Anonymous couple from Buffalo?
No, they're not a couple. They're not a couple. Oh. They've never met.
I see.
The laboratory was a laboratory in Buffalo. And so they put an ad in Buffalo newspapers, and they got random volunteers from Buffalo. They got about 20 of them, and chose at random this sample and that sample and that sample. So nobody knows who they are.
And what about Solera? Whose DNA are they mapping? They also got a bunch of volunteers, around 20, and picked 5 lucky winners.
We tried to have some diversity in terms of we had an African American, somebody's self-proclaimed Chinese ancestry, 2 Caucasians, and a Hispanic. So some of the volunteers were here on the staff. And
I have to ask, because everybody does, are you one of them?
I am one of the volunteers, yes.
Oh. Do you know whether you are one of the winners?
I have a pretty good idea, yes. But I can't disclose that. Because it doesn't matter.
Well, anybody, if you're the head of the company and you're watching the decoding of moi, that has a little Miss Piggy quality to it.
Well, any scientist that I know would love to be looking at their own genetic code. I mean, how could you not want to when work in this field?
Well, I don't know. I don't work in this field. But I do wonder, could any small group, and could that guy from Buffalo, could he really be a stand-in for all humankind? Hasn't it been drummed into us since birth that we're all different, each and every one of us completely unique? We certainly look different. People come in so many shapes and colors and sizes. The DNA of these humans has got to be significantly different from the DNA of this human, right?
The genetic difference between any two people, 0.1%. Those two and any two people on this planet are 99.9% identical at the DNA level. It's only 1 letter in 1,000 difference.
And if I were to bring secretly into another room a black man, an Asian man, and a white man, and show you only their genetic code, could you tell which one was the white?
Probably not. What's going on? Well, it tells us that first, as a species, we are very, very closely related, because any two humans being 99.9% identical means that we're much more closely related than any two chimpanzees in Africa.
Wait. You mean if two chimpanzees are swinging through the forest and you look at the genes of chimp A and the genes of chimp B...
Average difference between average those chimps is 4 or 5 times more than the average difference between two humans that you would pluck off this planet.
Because we're such a young species?
That's right. See, the thing is, we are the descendants of a very small founding population. Every human on this planet goes back to a founding population of perhaps 10 or 20,000 people in Africa about 100,000 years ago. That little population didn't have a great deal of genetic variation, and what happened was it was successful, it multiplied all over the world, but in that time, relatively little new genetic variation has built up. And so we have today on our planet about the same genetic variation that we walked out of Africa with.
So people are incredibly similar to each other. But not only that, it turns out we also share many genes with, well, everything.
50% of the genes in a banana?
How different are you from a banana?
I feel, and I feel I can say this with some authority, very different from a banana.
You may feel different from a banana.
I eat a banana, but yeah. I have never...
But look, you've got cells. You've got to make those cells divide. All the machinery for replicating your DNA, all the machinery for controlling the cell cycle, the cell surface, for making nutrients, all that's the same in you and a banana. Deep down, the fundamental mechanisms of life were worked out only once on this planet. And
and they've gotten reused in every organism. The closer and closer you get to a cell, the more you see, you know, a bag with stuff in it and a nucleus, and most of those basic functions are the same. Evolution doesn't go reinvent something when it doesn't have to. Take baker's yeast. Baker's yeast, we're related to 1.5 billion years ago. But even after 1.5 billion years of evolutionary separation, the parts were still interchangeable for lots of these genes.
Now, does that mean, I just want to, I'm sure if I understand this right, does that mean when you look through those things at all the C's and the A's and the T's and the T's and the G's, are you seeing the exact same letter sequences in the exact same alignment? When you look at the yeast and you look at the person, is it CCCATTT?
It's eerie. The gene sequence is almost identical. There are some genes like ubiquitin that's 97% identical between humans and yeast, even after 1 billion years of evolution.
Well, with a name like that, it's got to be.
Well, yeah, but you've got to understand that deep down, we are very much partaking of that same bag of tricks that evolution's been using to make organisms all over this planet.
It seems incredible, but all this information about evolution, about our relationship to each other and to all living things, it's all right here in this monotonous stream of letters. And as the Human Genome Project progressed and hit high gear, the pace of discovery quickened. Once they got fully automated, it wasn't long before Lander and Collins and all the other public project teams had reason to celebrate.
I'm Francis Collins, the director of the National Human Genome Research Institute, and we are happy to be here together to have a party today.
By November of 1999, they had reached a major milestone. In a five-way award ceremony hooked up by satellite, the major university teams announced they had finished 1 billion base pairs of DNA, a third of the total genome.
We got everybody? I would like to propose a toast. 1 billion base pairs, all on the public internet available to anybody in the world. It's an incredible achievement. It hasn't been completely painless. And because I know everybody in this room is living and breathing and thinking every single moment of the day about how to make all this happen, how we can hit full scale, I want to be sure you realize what a remarkable thing we pulled off. I hope you also know that this is history. Whatever else you do in your lives, you're part of history. And we're part of an amazing effort on the part of the world to produce this. And this isn't going to be like the moon where we just visit occasionally. This is going to be something that every student, every doctor uses every day in the next century and the century after that. It's something to tell your kids about. It's something to tell your grandkids about. It's something you should all be tremendously proud of. And I'm tremendously proud of you. A toast to this remarkable group, to the work we've done, to the work ahead.
Here.
Everybody here is hoping the Genome Project will help cure disease. And the sooner it's done, the better for all of us.
They get to sequence it before us.
Yeah, I guess he wants to keep some of it.
But there's something more than idealism, more than even pride, that's driving this race to finish the genome. And that's the knowledge that with every day that passes, more and more pieces of our genome are being turned into private property by way of the U.S. Patent Office.
I said property.
The office is inundated with requests for patents for every imaginable invention, from Star Wars action figures to jet engines. And here, along with all those gizmos, are requests for patents for human genes. Things that exist naturally in every one of us. How is this possible?
We regard genes as a patentable subject matter as we regard almost any chemical. We have issued patents on a number of compounds, a number of compositions that are found in the human body. For example, the gene that encodes for insulin has been patented, and that now is used to make almost all of the insulin that is made. So people's lives are being saved today. Diabetics' lives are better. As a matter of fact, if we ruled out every chemical that's found in the human body, there'd be an awful lot of inventions that were not able to be protected.
Generally, to patent an invention, you've got to prove that it's new and useful. But a few years ago, critics said that the patent office wasn't being tough enough. So applicants would say, well, here's a brand new sequence of A's, C's, T's, and G's right out of our machines. That's new. Now, useful. What are they going to be used for? Well, they were kind of vague about use, says Eric Lander.
The sort of thing that people used to do then was they would say, it could be used as a probe to detect itself. It's a trivial use. I mean, it's like saying, I could use this new protein as packing peanuts to stuff in a box. I mean, it's true.
Well, wouldn't the patent examiner say, that's not useful?
No. You see, the patent guidelines were very unclear. I don't object to giving somebody that limited time monopoly when they've really invented a cure for a disease, some really important therapy. I do object to giving a monopoly when somebody has simply described a couple hundred letters of a gene, has no idea what use you could have in medicine, because what's going to happen is you've given away that precious monopoly to somebody who's done a little bit of work, and then the people who want to come along and do a lot of work to turn it into a therapy, well, they've got to go pay the person who already owns it. I think it's a bad deal for society.
It takes at least 2 years for the patent office to process a single application. So right now, the patent office says there are about 20,000 genetic patents waiting for approval. All of them are in limbo. This can cause problems for drug companies who are trying to work with genes to cure disease.
I'm a company trying to do work on this, this, and this rung of the ladder.
Right.
Because I think that I could maybe develop a cure for cancer right here,
yep,
for the sake of argument. But of course, I have to worry that somebody owns this space.
Oh, you have to worry a lot. That this region here that you're working on that might cure cancer has already been patented by somebody else, and that patent filing is not public. And so you're living with the shadow that all of your work may go for naught.
Because one day the phone rings and says, sorry, you can't work here, get off my territory.
That's right.
Or you can work here, but I'm going to charge you $100,000 a week. Or you can work here and I'll charge you a nickel, but I want 50% of whatever you discover.
And the problem there is it's even worse, because many companies don't start the work whenever there's a cloud over who owns that. If there's uncertainty, companies would rather be working someplace where they don't have uncertainty, and therefore I think work doesn't get done because of the confusion over who owns stuff.
Supporters of patents say they are a crucial incentive for drug companies. Drug research is phenomenally expensive, but if a company can monopolize a big discovery with a patent, it can make hundreds of millions of dollars. Research scientists suddenly find themselves in an unfamiliar world ruled by big money.
Every scientist who does research is now being looked upon as a generator of wealth. Even if that person is not interested in it, if they sequence some DNA, that could be patentable material. So whether the scientist likes it or not, he or she becomes an entrepreneur just by virtue of doing science.
Craig Venter is first a scientist, but he has made the leap from academia into the business world.
Well, let me talk about the business of this. Do you consider yourself a businessman?
No, in fact, I still sort of bristle at the term for some reason. But my philosophy is we would not get medical breakthroughs in this country at all if it wasn't done in a business setting. We would not have new therapies if we didn't have a biotech and pharmaceutical industry.
But are they, if you bristle at the word businessman, that might be because in some part of your soul you may think
that the business of science and the business of business are fundamentally incompatible for one simple reason, that the business has to sell something and the science has to learn or teach something.
I think I bristle at it because it's used as an attack, used as a criticism. In this case, if the science is not spectacular, if the medicine is not spectacular, there will be no profits.
Venter was given $300 million to set up Celera, and his investors are expecting something in return. But how can they profit from the genome? At the moment, the company is banking on pure computer power. This is Celera's master control. 24 hours a day, technicians monitor all the company's major operations, including the hundreds of sequencers that are constantly decoding our genes. And they oversee Celera's main source of income, a massive website where, for a fee, you can explore several genomes, including those of fruit flies, mice, and, of course, humans. What all this adds up to is something like a big browser, a user-friendly interface between you and your genes.
Our business is to sell products that enable research. That's essentially what we do. So we're used to selling the picks and the shovels to the miners. Tools to interpret the human genome and other related species are merely more products along the same genre. They just happen to be less tangible than a machine.
So Celera's business plan is to gather information from all kinds of creatures, put it together, and sell their findings to drug companies or universities or whomever. But it's the selling part, selling scientific information, that makes some scientists very uncomfortable.
This is a big change in the ethos of the scientific community, which is supposedly it was built upon the idea of communitarian values, of the free and open exchange of information, the fundamental idea that when you learn something, you publish it immediately, you share it with others. Science grows by this communitarian interest of shared knowledge.
I think, why doesn't Pfizer give away their drugs? They could help a lot more people if they didn't charge for them.
At what point is free really free?
I mean, at some price level.
Tony White has absolutely no problem with making money from the human genome.
I hope we have a legal monopoly on the information. I hope our product is so good and so valuable to people that they feel that it's necessary to come through us to get it. Anybody that wants to can build all the tools that we're going to build. Whether or not they will choose to is a different matter.
And which is the better business to be in, do you think? The landlord business or this you subscribe and I'll give you some information about anything you want business?
They're both lousy businesses. The business to be
lousy?
In, they're lousy businesses by comparison with the real business. Make drugs. Actually make molecules that cure people.
Curing people is the whole point, right? But if there is one thing that the Human Genome Project has taught us, it's that finding cures is a whole lot harder than simply reading letters of DNA. Take, for example, the case of little Riley Dimanche. At 2 months, Riley appears to be a perfectly healthy baby boy, but he's not. When Riley was just 13 days old, Kathy Dimanche got the call that every parent dreads.
My pediatrician called on a Thursday evening, and he said, I need to talk to you about the baby. He said, are you sitting down? And I'm like, yeah, and that really surprised me. And he said, are you holding the baby? Because he didn't want me to drop the baby, obviously. And he said that tests came through and Riley tested positive to cystic fibrosis. And I was in shock.
As Kathy and her husband would soon learn, cystic fibrosis, CF for short, attacks several organs of the body, but especially the lungs. Its victims suffer from chronic respiratory infections, and half of all CF patients die before the age of 30.
Sounds good.
Good.
Sounds great.
But I think we can still be hopeful that their child will grow up to have a normal, healthy, happy, and long life. But at the present time, I don't have any guarantees about that.
Someone had asked me, are you prepared to bury, you know, your son at such a young age, whether it's 4 or 40? And he was 17 days old when that happened. And I said, I've had him for 17 days. I wouldn't trade those 17 days.
Finding the genetic defect that causes CF was big news back in 1989.
Medical researchers say they have discovered the gene which is responsible for cystic fibrosis, the most common inherited fatal disease in this country.
We're going to cure this disease.
A lot of people expected the cure to arrive any day. It didn't. Francis Collins, now head of the government's genome project, led one of the teams that discovered the CF gene.
We still have not seen this disease cured or even particularly benefited by all of this wonderful molecular biology. CF is still treated pretty much the way it was 10 years ago, but that is going to change.
The original hope was that babies like Riley could be cured by gene therapy, medicine that would provide a good working copy of a broken gene. But attempts at gene therapy have hardly ever worked. They remain highly controversial, so if there's going to be an effective treatment for Riley, instead of fixing his genes, we're going to take a look, and this is new territory, at his proteins.
What do proteins do?
When you look at yourself in the mirror, you don't see DNA, you don't see RNA. You see proteins and the result of protein action. That's what we are physically composed of.
So it's not a Rodgers and Hammerstein thing where one guy does the tune and the other guy does the lyrics. This is a case where the genes create the proteins and the proteins create us.
That's right. We are the accumulation of our proteins and our protein activities.
A protein starts out as a long chain of different chemicals, amino acids. But unlike genes, proteins won't work in a straight line.
Genes are effectively one-dimensional. If you write down the sequence of A, C, G, and T, that's kind of what you need to know about that gene. But proteins are three-dimensional. They have to be, because we're three-dimensional and we're made of those proteins. Otherwise, we'd all sort of be linear, unimaginably weird creatures.
Here's part of a protein. Think of them as tangles of ribbon. They come in any number of different shapes. They can look like this, or like this, or this. The varieties are endless. But when it's created, every protein is told, here is your shape. And that shape defines what it does, tells all the other proteins what it does, and that's how they recognize each other when they hook up and do business. In the protein world, your shape is your destiny.
They have needs and reasons to want to be snuggled up against each other in a particular way. And actually, a particular amino acid sequence will almost always fold in a precise way.
Should I think origami-like? I mean, should I think folding and then...
It's very elegant, very complicated, and we still do not have the ability to precisely predict how that's going to work. But obviously, it does work.
Except, of course, if something does go wrong. And that's what happened to baby Riley.
Yes.
Riley has a tiny error in his DNA. Just 3 letters out of 3 billion are missing. But because of that error, he has a faulty gene. And that faulty gene creates a faulty or misshapen protein. And just the slightest little changes in shape and boom, the consequences are huge. Because it is now misshapen. And a key protein that's found in lung cells, in fact, in many cells, can't do its job. So let's take a look at some real lung cells we'll travel in. This is the lining or the membrane of a lung cell, and here's how the protein is supposed to work. The top of your screen is the outside of a cell, the bottom of the screen, the inside of the cell, of course, and our healthy protein is providing a kind of chute so that salt can enter and leave the cell. Those little green bubbles, that's salt. And as you see here, the salt is getting through. But if the protein is not the right shape, then it's not allowed into the membrane. It can't do its job.
And without that protein, as you see here, salt gets trapped inside the cell, and that triggers a whole chain of reactions that makes the cell surface sticky and covered with thick mucus.
The first two positions that are done sitting up are probably a little more difficult to do.
That mucus has to be dislodged physically.
Okay.
Riley's family is learning to loosen the mucus that may develop in his lungs and fight infections with antibiotics.
You want to sort of do it with a cupped hand.
Trying to get at the top of the lungs.
Yeah, like,
but what the doctors and the scientists would love to do is if they can't fix baby Riley's genes, then maybe there's some way to treat Riley's misshapen protein and restore the original shape. Because if you could just get them shaped right, the protein should become instantly recognizable to other proteins and get back to business. But look at these things. How would we ever learn to properly fold wildly multidimensional proteins? It may be doable, but it won't be easy.
The Genome Project was a piece of cake compared to most other things because genetic information is linear. It goes in a simple line up and down the chromosome. Once you start talking about the three-dimensional shapes into which protein chains can fold and how they can stick to each other in many different ways to do things, or the ways in which cells can interact, like wiring up in your brain, you're not in a one-dimensional problem anymore. You're not in Kansas anymore.
And as scientists head into the world of proteins, they're looking very closely at patients like Tony Ramos. Tony has cystic fibrosis, but it's not the typical case. CF almost always develops in early childhood. Tony didn't have any symptoms till she was 15.
I started having a cough, and then we kept thinking I was catching a lot of colds. And my stepmother thought, you know, that's not right. So I started going to doctors trying to figure it out and went through a lot of tests because I don't fit the profile. Tuberculosis, walking pneumonia, you know, test after test.
At the time of her diagnosis, Tony's family was told she might not survive beyond her 21st birthday. She's now in her mid-40s. But her CF is worsening. Two or three times a year, she does have to be admitted to the hospital to clean out her lungs.
Temperamental. You know, they were always doing some little funky study to help the cause because we're not the normal, you know, there's not a whole lot of us. I know that they don't know why, you know, and it's the big question mark, and hopefully, you know, research will keep going and figure it out.
Here's the question. Tony was born with a mistake in the same gene as baby Riley. And yet, for some reason, when Tony was a baby, she didn't get sick. Why? And now that she is sick, she hasn't died. Why? What does Tony have that the other CF patients don't have? Dr. Craig Girard believes the answer lies in her genes, in her DNA.
How are you?
So,
do you think the change in the antibiotics is helping you?
Yes.
Yeah.
And I dropped 4 pounds overnight.
That's a lot of weight.
Yeah.
Okay. Mind if I have a listen?
Nope.
No gene acts in isolation. It is always acting as a part of a larger picture. And there can therefore be other genes which compensate.
Could it be that Tony has some other genetic mutations, good mutations, that are producing good proteins that kept her healthy for 15 years and are keeping her alive right now?
You sound a lot better than you did when you came in. So I think you're on the mend. Okay, hang in there.
Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.
In my opinion, there are genes that are allowing her to have a more beneficial course, if you will, than another patient.
Sound good.
Dr. Girard is searching for the special ingredient in Tony. If it turns out she has one or two good proteins that are helping her, maybe we could bottle them and use them to help all CF patients, like baby Riley.
Knowing that if there was ever an emergency and I didn't know how to do it and I couldn't get in touch with you.
No one can predict Riley's future or to what extent CF will affect his life. But now that we're getting the map of our genes, we'll be able to take the next big step. Because what genes do, basically, is they make proteins.
I get the sense that everybody's getting out of the gene business and suddenly going into this new business I hear about called the protein business. There's even a new name. Instead of the genome, I'm hearing this other name, which I...
The proteome.
The proteome.
Yes.
What is that?
Well, the genome is the collection of all your genes and DNA. The proteome is the collection of all your proteins. See, what's happening is we're realizing that if we wanted to understand life, we had to start systematically at the bottom and get all the building blocks. The first building blocks are the DNA letters. From them, we can infer the genes. From the genes, we can infer the protein products that they make that do all the work of your cell. Then we've got to understand what each of those proteins does, what its shape is, how they interact with each other, and how they make kind of circuits and connections with each other. So in some sense, this is just the beginning of a very comprehensive, systematic program to understand all the components and how they all connect with each other.
All the components and how they connect. But how many components are there? How many genes and how many proteins do we have?
A real shock about the genome sequence was that we have so many fewer genes than we've been teaching our students. The official textbook answer is the human has 100,000 genes. Everybody's known that since the early 1980s. The only problem is it's not true. Turns out we only have 30,000 or so genes.
30,000 genes? That's it? Not everybody agrees with this number, but that's about as many as a mouse. Even a fruit fly has 14,000 genes.
That's really bothersome to many people, that we only have about twice as many genes as a fruit fly, because we really like to think of ourselves as a lot more than twice as complex.
Well, don't you?
I certainly like to think of myself that way. And so it raises two questions. Are we really more complex?
You show me the fruit fly that can compose like Mozart, and then I'll, you know.
Yeah, well, show me the human that can fly, right? So, we all have our talents, right?
I suppose we do, but as it happens, we have lots of genes that are virtually identical in us and fruit flies. But happily, our genes seem to do more. So let's say that I am a fruit fly. One of my fruit fly genes may make one and two slightly different proteins. But now I'm a human, and the very same gene in me might make one, two, three, four different proteins. And then these four proteins could combine and build even bigger and more proteins.
Turns out that the gene makes a message, but the message can be spliced up in different ways. And so a gene might make three proteins or four proteins, and then that protein can get modified. There could be other proteins that stick some phosphate group on it, or two phosphate groups. And in fact, all of these modifications to the proteins could make them function differently. So while you might only have, say, 30,000 genes, you could have 100,000 distinct proteins, and when you're done putting all the different modifications on them, there might be a million of them. Scary thought.
So starting with the same raw ingredients, the fruit fly goes, but the human, by somehow or other being able to arrange all the parts in many different ways, can produce melodies, perhaps.
Yes, although we're not that good at hearing the melodies yet. One of the exciting things about reading the genome sequence now is we're getting a glimpse at that complexity of the parts and how it's a symphony rather than a simple tune. But it's not that easy to just read the sheet music there and hear the symphony that's coming out of it.
Okay, so it's not just the number of genes, it's all the different proteins they can make and then the way those proteins interact. And to figure out all those interactions and how they affect health and disease, that's going to keep scientists very busy for the next few decades. But of course, before the research can begin in earnest, they first have to complete the parts list, all the genes. And by the spring of 2000, both sides, the public labs and Celera, they were in hyperdrive, each camp madly trying to be the first to reach the finish line and get all 3 billion letters.
The pace of things and the magnitude of things was really incredible. I mean, I would remember coming in and just having this really gripping feeling in my gut, just an intense kind of, oh my God, am I up to this?
you know, whoever has this reference sequence of the human genome out there in the world first, they're going to be famous. They're going to be on the front page of the New York Times and a lot more than that. For a long time, they're going to be, you know, celebrities. And, you know, when that's going on, it's not unreasonable that people are going to reach for that star and try to get there before the other person.
I thought that the really intense competition in this world were among businesses where there was a profit motive. I now find that we are pikers in the business world compared to the academic competition that exists out there. And I'm beginning to understand why, because their currency is publication. Their currency is attribution. And their next funding comes from their last victory.
I think we're all better off for the fact that there is this competition. What you want is a system that gets people riled up and try to do something faster, better, and cheaper than the next guy.
The environment at Solaris was extremely intense, and it reminded me of finals week at Caltech. And there's a tradition at Caltech that on the very first day of finals week, the Ride of the Valkyries is played at full blast. And so I thought, well, since every week feels like it's finals week here, why don't I play the ride and see what happens? So we got a whole bunch of Viking hats, and we end up buying Nerf bows, okay, because we're Nordic Valkyrians. So the next week, we're shooting each other. We go, you know, there's something not right about this. So we decided the next week that we'd start doing raiding parties and raid some of the other teams. Unbeknownst to us, they had been preparing themselves.
Hey, you guys go to the back stairs.
They had little beanie hats, okay, and their own Nerf weapons. Then the war started. It's a way of kind of dealing with the pressure, I think. We all ran around like crazy for 5 or 10 minutes and, you know, got a little physical exercise. And had a few laughs, and then we're ready to really go after it.
The Wagner seems to be working. Output at Solera continues at a relentless pace.
If you have problems, call us back, okay?
Venter insists that the urgency stems not only from a desire to beat the government project, but the firm belief that what's coming out of these machines, all the A's and C's and T's and G's, will have a profound impact on all our lives.
It's a new beginning in science. And until we get all that data, that can't really take place. I mean, anybody that has cancer, anybody that has a family member with a serious disease, this data and information offers them tremendous hope that things could change in the future.
In the past, if you wanted to explain diabetes, you always had to scratch your head and say, well, it might be something else we've never seen before. But knowing that you've got the full parts list radically changes biomedical research, because you can't wave your hands and say it might be something else. There is no something else.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. C's in a row.
In the past, finding genes that cause a disease was a painstakingly slow process. But with the completion of a list, it should be much easier to make a direct connection from disease to gene. But how? Well, let's say I'm looking for a gene that causes something. We'll make it male pattern baldness. How would I go about that? Well, I'd want to get a bunch of bald guys. So here are 3 bald guys, and take their blood and look at their DNA. Now I'll take 3 guys with lots of hair, and here is their DNA, and what if the bald guys all share a particular spelling right here in this spot, which we will call the bald spot, and at the same spot, you notice the hairy guys have, see that? A different spelling. So, is this the gene that causes baldness? Maybe, but probably not. This could be a coincidence. So, How do I improve my chances of finding the specific spelling difference that relates to baldness? It would help if I knew that the bald guys and the hairy guys had really similar DNA, except for the genes I suspect may make them bald or hairy. Where do I find guys who are very, very similar with, you know, a few exceptions? A family, right? If there were brothers and fathers and sons and cousins, for instance, who share lots of genes. So let's say these three guys are brothers, astonishing similarity really in the face, but notice that one of them is hairy and two are bald. Whatever is making this one different should stand out when you compare their genes. And same for these guys. There's a difference clearly in the photos, but that difference may turn up in the genes. You can do the same thing for any disease you like. So if I could comb through the DNA of lots of people who are related, and I find some of them are sick and some of them are healthy, I might have a much better chance of figuring out which genes are involved. But where do I do this? Well, one place is a little island nation in the North Atlantic, Iceland. In many ways, Iceland is the perfect place to look for genes that cause diseases. It's got a tiny population, only about 280,000 people, and virtually all of them are descended from the original settlers, Vikings, who came here over 1,000 years ago.
If you drive around this country, you will have great difficulties finding any evidence of the dynamic culture that was here for all these 1,100 years. There are no great buildings, there are no monuments.
But one thing Iceland does have is a fantastic written history, including almost everybody's family tree. And now it's all in a giant database. Just punch in a social security number, and there they are, all your ancestors, right back to the original Viking.
So what we have here is my ancestor tree. I'm here at the bottom. This is my father and mother, my grandparents, great-grandparents, and so on. We can find an individual that was one of the original settlers of Iceland. Here we have Ketill Bjarnason, called Ketill Flatnefur, meaning he had a flat nose, so he may have broken it in a fight or something. And we estimate that he was born around the year 805.
Kari Stefansson is a Harvard-trained scientist who saw the potential gold mine that might be hidden in Iceland's genetic history. He set up a company called Decode Genetics to combine age-old family trees with state-of-the-art DNA analysis and computer technology and systematically hunt down the genes that cause disease.
Our idea was to try to bring together as much data on healthcare as possible, as much data on genetics as possible and the genealogy, and simply use the informatics tools to help us to discover new knowledge, discover new ways to diagnose, treat, and prevent diseases.
One of Decode's first projects was to look for the genes that might cause osteoarthritis. Reinheidir Magnus Dottir had the debilitating disease most of her life.
The first symptoms appeared when I was 12, and by the age of 14, my knees hurt very badly. No one really paid any attention. That's just the way it was. But by the age of 39, I'd had enough, so I went to a doctor.
Mrs. Magnus Dottir was never alone in her suffering. She is one of 17 children. 11 of them were so stricken with arthritis they had to have their hips replaced. This was exactly the kind of family that Decode was looking for. They got Mrs. Magnus Dottir and other members of her family to donate blood samples for DNA analysis. And to find more of her relatives, people she'd never met, Decode just entered her social security number into their giant database, and there they were. But which of these people have arthritis? To find out, Stefansson asked the government of Iceland to give his company exclusive access to the entire country's medical records. In exchange, Decode would pay $1 million a year plus a share of any profits. That way, Decode could link everything in their computers, DNA, health records, and family trees.
This idea was probably more debated than any other issue in the history of the Republic. On the eve of the parliamentary vote on the bill, there was an opinion poll taken which showed that 75% of those who took a stand on the issue supported the passage of the bill, 25% were against it.
Among that 25% against the plan were most of Iceland's doctors.
I felt that there was something fundamentally wrong in all of this, you know. They do know everything about you, not only about your medical history, about your medical past, but they know, do have your gene, the DNA. They know about your future, about something about your children, about your relatives.
We find ourselves paralyzed because there is really nothing we can do, because the one who takes the responsibility is the management of the health center. If they give away this information from the medical records, they get money. And everybody needs money. The health care really needs money.
So what's really the problem here? Well, let's take a hypothetical example. I'm going to make all this up. Let's pretend these are medical records of an average person. And we'll suppose that right here I see an HIV test. And then over here is medication for anxiety after what appears to be a messy divorce. And over here, a parent who died of Alzheimer's. Now, this is all stuff that could happen to anybody, but do you want it all in some central computer bank, and do you want it linked in the same computer to all your relatives and to your own personal DNA file? And should anybody have the right to go on a fishing expedition through your medical history and your DNA? Well, it may be frightening, but it also might work. Decode claims it's discovered several genes that may contribute to osteoarthritis. So this approach, combining family trees, medical records, and DNA, could lead to better drugs or to cures for a whole range of diseases.
To have all of the data in one place, so you can use the modern, you know, informatics equipment to juxtapose the bits and pieces of data and look for the best fit, is absolutely fascinating possibility.
Stephenson says no one's forced to do this, and there are elaborate privacy protections in place. No names are used, social security numbers are encoded. He also argues that the DNA part of the database is voluntary.
The healthcare database only contains healthcare information. We can cross-reference it with DNA information, but only from those individuals who have been willing to give us blood, allowing us to isolate DNA, genotype it, and cross-referencing it with the database. Only from those who have deliberately taken that risk. So it's not imposed on anyone. And no one who is scared of it, you know, no one who is really afraid of it, should come and give us blood.
DNA databases are popping up all over the world, including the US. They all have rules for protecting privacy, but they still make ethicists nervous.
I like to use the analogy of the DNA molecule to a future diary. There's a lot of information in the DNA molecule. The reason I call it a diary, a future diary, is because I think it's that private. I don't think anybody should be able to open up your future diary except you.
One rather bleak vision of where all this could lead is presented in the Hollywood film Gattaca. This is a world where everybody's DNA, everybody's future diary, is an open book. Everyone who can afford to has their children made to spec. But what happens to the poor slob who was conceived the old-fashioned way?
I'll never understand what possessed my mother to put her faith in God's hands rather than those of her local geneticist. 10 fingers, 10 toes, that's all that used to matter. Not now. Now, only seconds old, the exact time and cause of my death was already known.
Neurological condition, 60% probability. Attention deficit disorder, 89% probability. Heart disorder, 99% probability. Life expectancy, 30.2
years. 30.2
years.
The nurse seems to know precisely what's going to happen to this baby, which is ridiculous, right? Never happened. Or is it possible that one day we will be able to look with disturbing clarity into our future 10, 20, even 70 years ahead?
That is one possible future, where this becomes so routine that at birth, everybody gets a profile that goes right to their medical record. One copy goes to the FBI, so we have an identification system for all possible crimes in the United States. One copy goes where? To the grade school, to the high school, to the college, to the employer, to the military. Like a horrific future. Although I have to say there are many in the biotech industry and the medical profession who think that's a terrific future.
In fact, a lot of the technology already exists now, today. These guys in the funny suits are making gene chips. The little needles are dropping tiny, nearly invisible bits of DNA onto glass slides. And where did the DNA come from? From babies, thousands of them. Each chip can support 80,000 different DNA tests.
So a single chip, in principle, will allow you to test, say, 1,000 babies for 80 different human diseases. So within a few minutes, you can have a readout for thousands or even tens of thousands of babies in a single experiment.
Already, babies are routinely tested for a handful of diseases, but with gene chips, everybody could be tested for hundreds of conditions.
Knowing is great, knowing early is even better, and that's really what the technology allows us to do.
Well, taking a test and knowing is great for the baby, anybody really, as long as there's something you can do about it.
But think about this, because sometimes there may be a test, but it might take 20 years or 50 years, 50 years to find a cure. So you could take the test and you could learn that there is a disease coming your way, but you can't do a thing about it. Do you still want to know? Or you could take the test, but the test won't say that you're going to get the disease. It'll simply say that you may get a disease. And as you know, there is a big difference between you will and you may.
I mean, it just now feels like
Lisa Kaplist and Lori Siegel are sisters who shared the wrenching experience of cancer in the family. Way back, there were three sisters, and then in 1979, the youngest of the three, Melanie, was diagnosed with ovarian cancer.
When my sister was diagnosed, my response was disbelief. She was 30 years old, and I'd never known anybody of that age to have ovarian cancer.
Melanie fought her cancer for 4 years, but died in 1983. It seemed an isolated piece of bad luck, but then just about a year later, Lisa discovered that she had breast cancer. She was only 34, but the cancer hadn't spread, so the long-term outlook seemed optimistic.
I actually had a radiation therapist who was tops in the field, wrote many books on breast cancer, and was very optimistic. And what I remember him saying is that he and I would grow old together.
And Lisa was fine for 12 years. And then she found another lump in the same breast.
It was the worst fear come true. The first time I could hold on to hope. The second time nobody was talking with me about living to be old.
When Lisa discovered her second cancer in 1996, scientists were just beginning to work out the link between breast and ovarian cancers that run in families. Mary Claire King was one of the scientists who discovered that changes or mutations in two specific genes make a woman's risk of breast and ovarian cancer much higher. The genes are called BRCA1 and 2.
BRCA1 and BRCA2 are perfectly healthy, normal genes that all of us have. But in a few families, mutations in these genes are inherited.
So So in a normal gene, so we're going to spell it out for you here, letter by letter. This is the normal sequence ending G, T, A, G, C, A, G, T. Now we're going to make a copy. Now we're going to lose two of the letters, just two, and then see, watch them shift over. You see that? This new configuration is a mutation which can often cause breast cancer.
In the United States and Western Europe and Canada, the risk of developing breast cancer for women in the population as a whole is about 10% over the course of her lifetime, with, of course, most of that risk occurring later in her life. For a woman with a mutation in BRCA1 or BRCA2, the lifetime risk of breast cancer is about 80%. It's very high.
Right around the time of Lissa's second bout of breast cancer, a test for BRCA mutations became available. Lissa and her sister Lori decided to be tested.
I do remember the day that I went to find out the results. Panic, terror. I mean, what was I going to find out? Talking about, you know, the blood surging through your temples. I mean, I just remember sheer terror.
Turns out Lori was fine, but Lissa discovered that she does carry a BRCA mutation. It is not easy waking up every morning wondering if today's the day you may get sick.
Any questions about the results from the biopsy from April?
No questions about the results. Again, it feels like often my life is dodging bullets.
With the second cancer, Lissa had her right breast completely removed and then another operation to take out her ovaries.
Okay, just keep a tight fist until I'm in.
She also has a high risk of cancer in her left breast. BRCA mutations are relatively rare and only cause maybe 5 or 10% of all breast cancer. But knowing that there's a BRCA mutation in the family affects everybody.
The gene doesn't go away. The time passed since the last cancer doesn't buy you the safety. And the consequences run through the family. And I suppose that for my daughter, who, again, has not shown any significant impact of this, the knowledge that there's a genetic component that she can't deny will, I'm sure, color her life in serious ways.
Lissa's son, Justin, is 21. Her daughter, Alana, is 18. There is a 50-50 chance that each of them has inherited the BRCA mutation from Lissa. The only way to know would be to take a test. And when should they do that? When is the right time?
I actually never really thought about it until biology this year, when my teacher posed a hypothetical, supposedly, question to people saying, what would you do? Can you imagine what you would do if you were faced with a situation where you knew that you might have this disease that would be deadly or it would cause you to be sick? And you could do a test that you could find out whether or not you had it. And I was sitting there in class saying, maybe it's not so hypothetical.
And then in her senior year of high school, Alana felt a lump in her own breast.
I did have the whole, oh, it can't be happening to me, not yet, kind of thing. I mean, I have the reservation in the back of my mind that eventually it may very well happen to me, and if it does, then I'll fight it then, I'll deal with it then, but I don't expect, or I definitely didn't expect for this to be happening to me when I was 17 years old.
Alana's lump was not cancer. And for now, she doesn't want the test, because if she knew that she had the bad gene, she'd only have two options, the choice of removing her breasts and ovaries to try to reduce her risk, or just to be closely monitored and wait.
She's followed every year. Seems a little young to, you know, have her have to face that. On the other hand, it also feels like the belt and suspenders technique, and just have to do everything we can do.
In the next 20 years, this family's predicament will become more and more common as more and more genes are linked to more and more diseases and more tests become available. But we will all have to ask, do we want to know?
And when we know, can we live with an answer that says, maybe, but maybe not?
Driving home from work today, I was tuned into public radio, and there was a professor of astronomy talking about a brand new telescope to look into the galaxies. And they're calling it the equivalent of the Human Genome Project. And I was thinking, not quite the equivalent of the Human Genome Project, because it's without some of the ethical, moral, angst, real people issues, where it's a bit of a roller coaster ride between, you know, this is going to hold answers and hope and treatments and interventions and cure, versus it's not clear what this all means.
And if things aren't clear now, what about the future when we may not only cure disease, but do so much more?
Your extracted eggs, Marie, have been fertilized with Antonio's sperm. You have specified hazel eyes, dark hair, and fair skin. All that remains is to select the most compatible candidate. I have taken the liberty of eradicating any potentially prejudicial conditions, premature baldness, myopia, alcoholism, obesity, etc.
We didn't want, diseases, yes, but...
Right, we were just wondering if it's good to just leave a few things to chance.
You want to give your child the best possible start. And keep in mind, this child is still you, simply the best of you. You could conceive naturally 1,000 times and never get such a result.
Gattaca really raised some interesting points. The technology that's being described there is, in fact, right in front of us, or almost in front of us.
That seems to me almost extremely likely to happen, because what parent wouldn't want, you know, to introduce a child that wouldn't have at least be where all the other kids could be?
That's why the scenario is chilling. It portrayed a society where genetic determinism had basically run wild. I think society in general has smiled upon the use of genetics for preventing terrible diseases. But when you begin to blur that boundary of making your kids genetically different in a way that enhances their performance in some way, that starts to make most of us uneasy.
What if we lived in the world of Star Trek Voyager? Talk about uneasy.
Computer, access Bellana Torres' medical file.
Lieutenant Torres is 50% human and 50% Klingon.
Project a holographic image of the baby.
She's also 100% pregnant.
Now extrapolate what the child's facial features will look like at 12 years old.
Like any caring parent, she doesn't want her unborn child to be teased for having a forehead that looks like, well, like a tire tread.
Display the fetus genome.
But here's the twist.
Delete the following gene sequences.
She can do something about it.
Extrapolate what the child would look like with those genetic changes.
She threw in some blonde hair, too. And is this the limit, or could we go even further?
Save changes.
If you can eventually isolate all these things, can you then build a creature that has never existed before? For example, I would like the eyesight of a hawk, and I like the hearing of a dog. Otherwise, I'm quite content to be exactly as I am. So could I pluck the eyesight and the hearing and patch it in?
Well, we don't know. We really don't know how that engineering occurs and how we can improve on it. It'd be very much like getting a whole pile of parts to a Boeing 777 and a whole pile of parts to an Airbus, and saying, well, I'm gonna mix and match some of these so it'll have some of the properties. I'll make it a little fatter, but I also wanna make it a little shorter. And by the time you were done, you'd think you'd made lots of clever improvements, but the thing wouldn't get off the ground. It's a very complex machine, and going in with a monkey wrench to change a piece, odds are most changes we would make today, almost all changes we'd make today, would break the machine.
We may not be able to genetically modify humans or Klingons yet, but we do it to plants and animals every day. Look at this stuff, tobacco plants with a gene from a firefly. And they use that same insect gene to create glowing mice. So it's theoretically possible
Sure.
that we could create humans with
other advantages that borrowed from other creatures.
That's right, but the humility of science right now is to appreciate how little we know about how you could even begin to go about that. That is the difference between 20th century and 21st century biology, is it's now our job in this century to figure out how the parts fit together.
And just as the 20th century was winding down, the race to finish the genome was reaching full throttle. The competitive juices were flowing.
I am competitive, but when the social order doesn't allow you to make progress, and it doesn't for most people, I said, to hell with the social order, well, I'll find a new way to do it.
It changed the paradigm on people, and people don't like that. It was very offensive to these people. How dare they, you know, rain on our parade? This is our turf.
This was a challenge to the whole idea of public generation of data. That's what offended people, was that we really felt deeply that these were data that had to be available for everybody, and there was an attempt to claim the public imagination for the proposition that these data were better done in some private fashion and owned.
You know, you want to say, well, wait a minute, you know, if you could do it in 2 years, why weren't you doing it in 2 years? Why did we have to come along to turn a 15-year project into a 2-year project?
I must say the Human Genome Project had a tremendous amount of internal competition, even amongst the academic groups. There's competition amongst academic scientists, to be sure, and more than anything, there's competition against disease. There's a strong sense that what we're trying to find out is the most important information that you could possibly get.
I don't know. I mean, I hope that this will all go away.
In June of 2000, it kind of did go away. The contentious race to finish the genome came to an end.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
And the winner was... Well, you probably heard, they decided to call it a tie.
I think both Craig and I were really tired of the way in which the representations had played out and wanted to see that sort of put behind us. It was probably not good for Celera as a business to have this image of being sort of always in contention with the public project. It certainly wasn't good for the public project to be seen as battling with a private sector enterprise.
So, Dr. Collins, please come up.
President Clinton himself got the public guys and the Celera guys to play nice, shake hands, and share credit for sequencing the genome.
Nearly two centuries ago, in this room, on this floor, Thomas Jefferson and a trusted aide spread out a magnificent map. The aide was Meriwether Lewis, and the map was the product of his courageous expedition across the American frontier all the way to the Pacific. Today, the world is joining us here in the East Room to behold a map of even greater significance. We are here to celebrate the completion of the first survey of the entire human genome. Without a doubt, this is the most important, most wondrous map ever produced by humankind.
And what does this map the President is talking about, what does it look like? When we look across the landscape of our DNA for the 30,000 genes that make up a human being, what do we see?
The genome is very lumpy.
Very lumpy,
uneven. You might think if we have 30,000 genes, they're kind of distributed uniformly across the chromosomes. Not so. They're distributed like people are distributed in America. They're all bunched up in some places, and then you have vast plains that don't have a lot of people in them. It's like that with the genes. There are really gene-dense regions that might have 15 times the density of genes. Sort of New York City over here. And there are other regions that might go for 2 million letters, and there's not a gene to be found in there. The remarkable thing about our genome is how little gene there is in it.